Good evening and a warm welcome to all the viewers joining us. Along with Dr. Mangesh Balerao, our medical head, I am Avinash Singh, and on behalf of RPG Life Sciences, I welcome all to this webinar on clinical and serological diagnosis of COVID-19. It's my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker for today, a renowned pediatrician, Dr. Vikram Samal. Welcome, Dr. Samal, and thank you for joining us. Dr. Samal is MD Pediatrics. He has completed his postgraduate program in pediatric nutrition from Boston and Columbia. Dr. Samal has also successfully completed his training in pediatric advanced life support and neonatal advanced life support. Moreover, he is also an assistant professor of pediatrics in Sishu Bhavan and SCB Medical College. Dr. Samal is widely recognized as one of the leading pediatrics in Cuttack. And with his expertise, it would be interesting to hear more from him in today's topic. So without wasting any further time, I welcome Dr. Samal and request him to please carry forward the session. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
Right. Welcome, everybody. Today is a very interesting topic I'm going to present, a very relevant topic for the today's times, clinical and serological diagnosis of COVID-19. We are right now in the midst of a pandemic. Pandemic is one of those rare things which all of us have been talking and reading about, but right now one we are facing. According to WHO, the disease caused by novel coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2, is now officially called COVID-19. COVID stands for coronavirus disease. Now, according to coronavirus study group of International Committee on Taxonomy of Virus, novel coronavirus 2019-nCoV is officially called SARS-CoW-2. WHO officially renamed it as COVID-19. The disease caused by SARS-CoV-2 has been officially renamed as COVID-19. Now, coming an overview of coronaviruses. Coronaviruses are a large family of viruses that commonly cause mild upper respiratory illnesses in people. The virus spreads similar to any other flu by coughing, sneezing, and respiratory droplets. Mind you, I have not said by aerosols, but respiratory droplets. Common symptoms include fever, coughing, shortness of breath. Symptoms are present by day two of exposure to, last up to 14 days of exposure to the virus. People are thought to be most contagious when they are symptomatic. Now, this is the map, global map, and shows the prevalence or density of the virus right now. And India, we are not doing any good. The WHO declared the coronavirus as a global health emergency long back. Now, coming on the latest on the coronavirus outbreak, this is dashboard, India's dashboard as of 15th August 2020. We have 25,65,074 cases we had by yesterday. That number has gone up significantly by today. There are 677,384 active cases with near about 50,000 deaths, and 18 lakh plus cases have been discharged successfully. Now, how does coronavirus spread? It spreads through air by coughing and sneezing. It can spread through close personal contact, such as touching or shaking hands. Touching an object or any fomite or surface with a virus on it, mouth, nose, or eyes. Now, what are the common clinical signs and symptoms? Like any flu, any viral flu, the signs and symptoms are indistinguishable from that of coronavirus. There might be fever. Fever can last up to 2 to 8 days. There will be cough. Cough can initially be mild, but as the disease progresses, mind you, the disease, viral disease, in COVID is either due to the viral inflammation, the virus causing the disease, as well as immune-mediated damage to the lungs causing the disease. So cough initially may be mild, but can progress significantly once the immune-mediated damage sets in. There can be shortness of breath, there can be myalgia, muscle ache, there can be confusion, headache. Sore throat is a very common symptom. Chest pain, there will be chest pain, there may be diarrhea, nausea, vomiting. Any CV, cardiovascular or cerebral disease, we are seeing CVAs in elderly people, or any respiratory disease other than previously mentioned. Now, how does it affect the body? You can see there can be headache, there can be sore throat, cough, pneumonia, can cause ARDS, can cause renal failure, can there be fever, runny nose, and finally the most dreaded, it can cause death. And we have been seeing it is one of the is the leading cause of death right now in India. Now, what is the timeline of onset? Once the patient is exposed, they name it as number of 0 day. So by day 7, this is a Lancet publication. By day 7, there will be hospital admission. By day 8, there will be shortness of breath. Hospital admission, then by day 8, there will be shortness of breath. And ARDS, if at all develops, it maximum chances of developing ARDS is by day 9 of exposure. And maximum chances of intensive unit care admission is by day 10. So common symptoms as we have seen are fever. It is found in 98% of cases, cough in 76% of cases, myalgia, fatigue. Mind you, these are the symptoms. These are only in symptomatic patients. There are a lot of patients that are around 80% of the cases are asymptomatic carriers. They will show no symptoms or signs, but they will be harboring the virus in them. 32% patients are admitted to ICU while 15% according to the study had died. But right now we are in India, we are in a slightly better state. We are seeing that 6% patients are being admitted to the ICU while with 2% case fatality. Now coming to the serological diagnosis of COVID-19, there are different types of diagnostic tests available. Some diagnostic tests detect infection, while others detect an immune response. Testing plays an important role in a public health response in this pandemic, because testing is the gold standard right now. Because as we see, if you do not limit the number of cases or do not contain the number of cases, then there will be exponential spread that happens. And we have been seeing that the exponential growth in the number of positive cases over the last 2 to 3 months. Coronavirus. Now, coming to immune response to COVID-19 infection, coronavirus has 4 structural proteins, the spike protein, the nucleocapsid, the envelope, and the membrane. During an infection, the body's immune system makes antibodies that bind themselves to the structural proteins and neutralize the virus. The body tries to neutralize the virus by its immunoglobulins. The spike and the nucleocapsid are the main proteins which trigger an antibody response in humans. Most important antibodies in the response as initially IgG and IgM takes over later. IgM antibodies are produced first, but IgG are produced later and are our only defense mechanism against the virus right now. Now coming to diagnostic testing for COVID-19, we can either detect the virus or the immune system, immune response to the virus. The viral RNA is detected by NAT or nucleic acid amplification test or RT-PCR. It is a reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. You can see the image of the COVID-19 viral antigen, the spike protein, the envelope protein, the membrane glycoprotein, as well as the nucleocapsid protein and the RNA inside. The immune response antibodies against COVID-19, we can detect the IgM, IgG, and IgA. Now, this is a very important graph. You can see by day 5, most of the patients are symptomatic. By day 5, of exposure, the symptoms start developing, and by day 7 to day 8, there will be florid symptoms. So this acute period of day 7 to day 8 is known as window period, when the patient is very difficult to diagnose clinically as well as serologically, because there will be no symptoms or there will be mild symptoms we cannot detect antigen also, and antibodies have not yet been developed. By day 8, the IgM starts developing initially, which goes on increasing till day 15 to day 16. There is a peak in the IgM by day 16 to day 17, and then it starts falling down and it most likely disappears by day 28 of the infection. The IgG, which is our only hope for a long-term protection, starts appearing by day 14 to day 15, and it keeps on rising. And by day 28, the same time when the IgM becomes undetectable, the IgG achieves its plateau and progresses with a similar level till at least 3 months of the post-exposure. Why I say 3 months? Because this disease has not been a long studied disease. So we have data till 3 months. The IgG persists in the body till 3 months enough level titers to prevent a further reinfection. We cannot comment about reinfection right now because as we are progressing by in our timeline, we're studying more and more about the disease, and we'll know about reinfection in times to come. Now coming to the second slide, by week one, we should be able to diagnose the disease. So PCR likely is positive in the first week or 1 week or week two. It can be also positive by week three. PCR detects the viral RNA. After week three, PCR is likely negative. By week two, end of week two, as we have seen, once the IgM achieves its peak, we can go for an antibody detection easily. So which substance to take from the body for a PCR study? See, initial period, the most early PCR to be positive is nasopharyngeal swab, or even more specific or attains better sensitivity or specificity rather is the bronchoalveolar lavage or the sputum PCR. Now, viral isolation from respiratory tract, if at all, can be done, but it is not highly sensitive. And we can also get stool PCR positive throughout the disease. So, stool PCR or stool viral RNA can be positive up to week 6 or week 7 of the disease. So, if somebody is getting stool PCR positive after week 3 or week 4, it does not signify that the patient is infective or patient is harboring the disease. The patient is harboring the virus, but fecal oral spread is highly unlikely in this case, because the RNA is a dead RNA and it won't cause any transmission. Now, by week 2, most of the RNA that those are persisting in the body are dead RNA. So, unlikely they are dead. It is even though if PCR comes out to be positive, there is a less likely chance of viral spread or contamination from those dead viral particles. So initially progressing with the pandemic, the ICMR had formulated that the criteria should be a negative PCR, but it was later modified to at least 10 days of symptomatic free. Then it was further modified to 3 days of symptomatic free disease. This is symptomatic phase, and you can discharge the patient. That is actually in a health compromised country like India. If you do not reduce the disease load, then it will fallacious for all the patients. So if the patient is not likely to transmit or the disease, then we should treat the patient at home. Now, what are the samples to be collected? As I already said, nasopharyngeal, oropharyngeal swabs, serum for serological testing. Recommendation for specimen collection in low respiratory specimen likely to have a higher diagnostic value than upper respiratory tract specimen. If patient don't have any signs and symptoms of lower respiratory tract infection, specimen collection is of low respiratory tract is not possible. Upper respiratory tract specimen should be collected. Now, this is a form. This I have already talked about how to collect the swab or lavage specimens and how to transport. Now, how to process? Initial processing is takes place in a biological safe cabinet to prevent further transmission by the testing. Laboratory work involving non-cloacative methods should be used in biosafety level 2 at least. Laboratory work involving propagative methods, virus culture isolation should be conducted at containment laboratory with inward direction flow in a biosafety level 3 facility. Disinfectant such as having action against enveloviruses should be used, like hypochlorite solution, alcohol, hydrogen peroxide, quaternary ammonium compounds, and phenolic compounds. Patient specimens from suspected or confirmed cases should be transported to biological substance category B, and viral cultures or isolates should be transported to category A. Now, transport, we need not talk much about this. This is a transport media. Now, coming to the diagnostic methods for detection of SARS-CoV-2, these are the tests available right now: the nucleic acid amplification test, viral sequencing, serology, and viral culture. Now, coming to nucleic acid amplification test, at present, confirmation of cases of COVID-19 is based on the detection of viral RNA or viral nucleic acid amplification test, such as real time or reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. The viral genes targeted so far as I have already discussed, NES, ORF, and RBRP genes. The real-time polymerase chain reaction is the most commonly used one for COVID-19. It is primarily based on PCR, a process that repeatedly copies and amplifies a specific genetic fragments of the virus, ensuring that there is enough of a sample to conduct the analysis. The RT-PCR test starts with a simple swab taken from inside of the throat or nose. Coronaviruses have RNA as their genetic material. Swabs from patient yield only a tiny quantity of RNA, which is not adequate for the testing process. To overcome this problem, a single-strand molecule is converted into a two-strand DNA using reverse transcription. The next step is use of primers. These small pieces of DNA designed only to bind to selected DNA sequence of the SARS-CoV-2 viral genome. Along with primer, the process uses a fluorescent dye, which acts as probe. The patient sample, the primer and probe are together left in PCR machine for binding process to take place. A fluorescent signal marks the presence of the virus. Now, of the following condition, one of the following conditions should be met to consider the case as laboratory confirmed case by NAT in areas with no SARS-CoV-2 circulation. A positive NAT for at least two different targets of the SARS-CoV-2 genome. One positive NAT for the presence of beta coronavirus and SARS-CoV-2 virus further identified by viral sequencing. I'll come to that, what is viral sequencing. A number of factors which lead to a negative result or can be a poor quality of specimen. If the specimen is taken from oral cavity rather than the nasopharyngeal or pharynx, then there is less chances of viral harboration there and less chances that the swab contains any viral RNA. The specimen was collected either late or very late, early in the infection. As I have said, there will be no viral load in the window period and there will be no viral load after 2 to 3 weeks. The specimen was not handled properly or not shipped properly, or there is viral mutation or PCR inhibition. The time duration for the testing process is around 4 to 8 hours, but results may take up to a day to arrive because of the time taken to transport samples to labs. Now, the sensitivity of this test is 66%. So that means even though this is our gold standard of testing right now, we're still missing 34% of cases with RT-PCR. The specificity of this test is more than 95%. That means RT-PCR, if positive, is highly likely that the disease is due to COVID-19. The RT-PCR test is also most expensive right now. The government has capped the test at $2,200 per test. Now, coming to antigen testing, right now we are seeing a surge in testing of COVID-19. Initially, RT-PCR was a gold standard. Right now, the government has added antigen testing, and which gives a diagnosis in 30 minutes. This test are designed to detect a specific protein in the virus that elicits the body's immune response. In the case of COVID-19, it is a spike protein present in the surface of the coronavirus that facilitates its entry in the human cell. For this test, the professional collect a nasal swab, which is then immersed in a solution that deactivates the virus. A few drops of this solution is then put on a test strip. This has to be done within an hour. The test strips contain specific artificial antibodies designed to bind to the COVID proteins. If a person is infected with coronavirus, the test lines will appear within 15 minutes. Since antigen testing does not involve any amplification process, swab samples may lack enough antigen material to be detectable, thus may give false negative results. For this reason, if a person tests negative through antigen testing, they still might need an RT-PCR for confirmation. But if a person tests positive, a confirmation RT-PCR is not required. Advantage of this test is that it reduces the burden of relying on RT-PCR to identify COVID-19. Sensitivity is around 50%, as I said. The chances of false negative is very high. Specificity, but is more than 90%. Now, coming to TrueNAT, this is the latest test that the government has added on May 19. ICMR revised this testing guideline to allow TrueNAT as one of the systems for screening and confirmation of COVID-19. This is a chip-based test, works by detecting SARS-CoV-2 E gene, which helps build the envelope. Unlike the traditional RT-PCR test, the sample preparation in TrueNAT is automated. Results are available within half an hour. The tests use nose or throat swab samples, which are collected from patients and dipped in a solution which inactivated the virus, which inactivates the virus. A few drops of the solution is then placed on the cartridge. On inserting this cartridge into a machine, a pre-programmed reaction is initiated. which extracts the nucleic acid or genetic material from the samples. This has to be followed by an RT-PCR. This solution is then applied to a microchip and the test is inserted in another machine, which is a reverse transcription, and PCR takes place. The advantage of this test, it is very quick. It is portable. Most importantly, this is portable. This allows teams to set up mobile testing centers or kiosks in containment zones instead of having to transport samples to labs. TrueNAT is indigenously developed portable version of CBNAT, which has been used for testing tuberculosis since long in our country. While both the test versions are cheaper and quicker than RT-PCR, TrueNAT is battery operated and portable, while CBNAT machine needs an uninterrupted power supply, hence cannot be deployed in containment zones. TrueNAT right now is priced at ₹1200. Now coming to viral sequencing, this is not done right now in a country, but India has a facility, but not done routinely for diagnosis of COVID-2 because of its cumbersome process. Advantage of this is it provides confirmation of the presence of virus. You can monitor the viral genome for its mutation that might affect the performance of medical countermeasures. Viral whole genome sequencing can also inform molecular epidemiology studies. Now coming to the serological tests, we can do a complement fixation, we can do a neutralization test, we can do ELISA, we can do hemagglutination inhibition, gel indirect immunofluorescence, or gel diffusion tests. But right now, we do ELISA in India. Antibodies can be useful to carry out surveys, which is very important. What is the advantage of an antibody test? It can be used to carry out surveys to check whether a population has been exposed to virus. These are currently only being used for research and surveillance purposes. What is the disadvantage? There is a lot of cross-reactivity. Of course, when antibodies produced against protein of one type of coronavirus bind weakly to that of COVID-19. Tests that detect antibodies of COVID-19 may cross-react with other coronavirus and thus giving false positive results. Antibody tests can be useful to carry out surveys to check whether population has been exposed. Coming to RDTs, these are simple and based on lateral flow immunoassay technology. And there is a drop of blood to detect the presence of antigen antibodies, IgG, IgM, or IgA, produced by the specific SARS-CoV-2 antigen. The results are available in 10 to 30 minutes. ELISA, the time taken is 2 to 5 hours. Most commonly used ELISA is sandwich or double antigen bridging assay. Now, what are the challenges of diagnosis in this disease? The challenge is that the sample collection is a very huge challenge because it is actually a difficult process to collect the sample. The chances are that the nasopharynx as well as the oropharynx may not harbor the virus, even though the patient is symptomatic. Then there is the transport, which the virus is highly heat sensitive. The transport of the virus in specific viral culture media is highly essential. The kit validation is also a major bottleneck in the diagnosis of COVID-19. The sensitivity of the testing kits is a matter of debate right now, as I said. 66, and the gold standard we have is RT-PCR, and is only 66% sensitive. A sizable number of patients may not be identified due to this low sensitivity. Availability of the point of care tests, which is required minimal biosafety requirements. Thank you. This is all I could talk about the clinical and serological diagnosis of COVID. I hope it helps every one of you.
Well, sir, thanks a lot. Thanks for wonderfully explaining this topic in very simple way. You have explained in depth the clinical and serological aspect, and we hope that it would be useful for the doctors. So what we'll do is, I would request the participants, if you have any questions, you can ask the questions to doctor by typing it in the Q&A box. Also, we have few questions in our WhatsApp box. Sir, first question is, what can be the post-corona complications, especially for pediatric patients? What precautions?
You meaning that post-corona complications once the child recovers?
Yeah.
See, this is a disease under study right now. So we do not have a huge amount of data to pinpoint this answer. But what we have seen that there may be chances of persistence of myalgia or even depression in children. Up to 3 months of age, 3 months of post-exposure, or 3 months of healing or recovering from the disease. So children have complained of myalgia as well as altered behavior. and maybe some cases they were have the patient have already been identified. Up to and that timeline can be up to 3 months of recovery.
Okay. Second question, sir, which is the most effective test, antigen test, TrueNAT test, or PCR, and what about the false positive result, which are increasing?
See, as I've already spoken, the active PCR is the gold standard right now because we are completely dependent on it. But with advance of the antigen tests, at least we are able, it may not be 100% sensitivity or may not even be 66% sensitive like on the RT-PCR, but it is still 50% sensitive, and we can identify at least the cases which we are missing before, and we can do it quickly and early and in without any having to spend a lot of time, like we have to at least wait for 8 to 10 hours for one RT-PCR, while we can do the antigen test in 30 minutes. So as you are talking that test, the positivity is increasing. Yes, you are absolutely right. The positivity is increasing. We are also doing more tests. So the graph where we show that the number, the percentage of positivity is actually still increasing. That means the disease is still spreading in India. Even though we are increasing the testing, the positivity or the amount of percentage of positive cases is still increasing.
Okay. One question in our Q&A box. What is the incidence of spread from children in India? Any opinion?
Exactly. But we exactly that is very different, difficult thing to answer. That we cannot say that incidence of spread from children exactly. We cannot quantify that. But yes, they can spread. Any symptomatic infected person, maybe a child or a adult, will spread the disease. It's not like that they cannot spread, they spread. But one good thing about disease of COVID-2 in COVID-19 in children is that there is less chances of the child being symptomatic. So we are, as pediatricians, are slightly spared that the child is less chance that the child may be as symptomatic or the disease is less fatal in children right now. We cannot say the future, but right now this is what we have seen.
One more question. Wonderful session, sir. You spoke about antibody effective for 3 months. So is there any chance of relapse?
Right now, as I've already said, this is a disease. We are learning more about it with every passing day. So there have been few spurious talks about reinfection. Relapse is absolutely not one of the things. Reinfection can be occurring, but that has been highly spurious and in patches on pockets. Like Korea, a few cases of reinfection they have suggested, and in Brazil also. But right now, it is not. One cannot say that one infection protects the person lifelong, or a reinfection can occur. So we'll know about this with coming passing time.
Okay.
There is one more question. Hi, sir. What's average time of the RT-PCR will come negative? What would be the duration once it comes?
As I have already said, this RT-PCR stays positive in nasopharyngeal swabs or oropharyngeal or respiratory specimens till at least 2 to 3 weeks. So the RT-PCR can come positive by up to 18 to 21 days of the infection. But that does not mean that the patient is under the disease at that time. As I have said, once the IgM starts developing and the viral load comes decreases, the patient is becomes asymptomatic or the symptoms subside, and there is less chance that the patient can be considered infective, or he can transmit the disease to someone else. One more thing, the RT-PCR detects viral RNA, so it can also detect the dead RNA. So even though RT-PCR can come positive up to 21 days, I have already said like that, it can come positive even later, but that is due to the dead RNA. So which is not that once that RT-PCR comes and we cannot stamp it as a case of COVID-19.
One more question we have. Someone is asking, patient was tested positive after 16 days of the first test. So is it possible, or what's the issue?
Yes, yes, absolutely possible. As I said, RT-PCR can come positive till 18 to 21 days, even later than that. But right now, the consensus of ICMR is that if the patient is asymptomatic and the test is positive after 2 weeks, then the most likely that patient does not need any treatment. Or even if we are admitting the patient, we are discharging by 2 to 3 days.
Two more questions we have, sir. What are the chances of breathlessness in a symptomatic COVID-19 patients?
Breathlessness is one of the pertinent features. Once there is respiratory involvement, initially there will be upper respiratory tract involvement, then there will be lower respiratory tract involvement. The virus can cause the disease, lower respiratory tract disease, by either directly infecting the lungs, causing pneumonia, and or there will be immune-mediated thromboembolism. As we have seen, the pathway the virus follows is that there is immune-mediated thromboembolism, or the microthrombi are formed in the lungs, which can cause damage to the lungs. Then the next step of progression is ARDS. The patient can lead to ARDS. So once the patient lands into ARDS, it's very highly unlikely for the patient, or it's very difficult for the patient to recover. So breathlessness will occur once there is low respiratory tract involvement. So it is very common.
Avinash.
If RT-PCR is negative and HRCT is positive, so what is your...
Exactly. So see, RT-PCR, as I already said, is 66% sensitive. But once there is a lungs involvement, HRCT actually has a better sensitivity, or is a better tool to diagnose. If HRCT shows features of viral pneumonia or even a microthrombi, as I said before, then it is most likely a COVID-19, even if the RT-PCR is negative. So we treat those patients as COVID-19, even though RT-PCR is negative. One more question is there in the Q&A. CRP is mostly elevated in most cases. Can it be taken as a tool? Is X-ray necessary if CRP is positive? See, CRP is not the marker here, but we use CRP in ICUs right now to monitor the progress of the disease. CRP, in a falling CRP, can suggest that the disease is improving, or a sudden spike in CRP can suggest that the disease has suddenly progressed. Then we do an interleukin-6 in those tests, interleukin-6 assay, to see if there is a cytokine storm has occurred. Cytokine storm is one of those sudden things that happen in this COVID-19. There is sudden burst of respiratory involvement, and then we lose the patient. So yes, CRP is essential for monitoring at least.
Now, what are the prognostic factors which are supporting the less mortality rate in pediatric patients?
See, that exactly has not been studied right now. I am not in exact position to answer that question. But what we see, that immunity of pediatric patients is different, is highly different from the adults. We normally speak that a pediatric patient, less than a 4-year child, is the immunity of the child is less than an adult, because the child is more susceptible to infections. But we do not see the same pattern in COVID-19. We see that at least to certain extent, the pediatric patients are protected. I exactly cannot predict or cannot pinpoint the factor why, but what the study has shown that the fixing proteins or the virus that gets attached to the respiratory layers is slightly different. The fixing protein in pediatric age group is slightly different. So there may be less chance of harboring the virus, so leading to less symptomatic pediatric patients.
That's great. That's great, sir. Very important information for our participants. There is a question which was there in chat box. Yeah, does the presence of antibody means that person is immune? Yeah.
See, if the patient develops antibodies, doesn't mean the patient is symptom free. IgM can come in the body even though the patient has symptomatic. I actually said before that the disease here is initially viral mediated, but once the virus immune system of the body takes over, it is no longer viral mediated. It becomes immune mediated. Once it becomes immune mediated, IgM won't help. So even though IgM is there in the body, it won't help. So that has to be treated specifically. But in an asymptomatic person, if IgM develops, that means the viral load has come down, and most likely the body's immunity has compensated for the disease. And once IgG develops, then most likely the patient is immune to the disease, at least for a certain time being.
Right.
One more question. Is there any basic level of CRP to suspect COVID in present seasonality fever?
As I said already, CRP is not the diagnostic measure, or is not, it cannot be used to predict. It is only right now used as a monitoring instrument in the ICUs or sick patients.
Can we put this question, sir, in a different way? Like, does CRP would help us to differentiate between COVID and seasonal flu?
No, we have seen that CRP comes positive even in seasonal flu or even in other viral infections. CRP is not highly sensitive or specific for that matter. So it is a body protein which a body emanates to counter any infection. So CRP can come positive in other seasonal fevers also. So it is not exactly a factor which you can use to differentiate COVID from other fevers.
Right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for taking the questions. Any concluding remark on your side?
No, this has been a highly interesting session, and I'm happy for those questions at least.
Thank you, Dr. Samal, for sharing your valuable time and knowledge with us.
Welcome.
It was a pleasure having you today with us, and we would like to hear from you again in near future.
Sure.
Also, thanks to all the viewers who have joined us. We can provide you the session link to all the viewers after permission from Samal, sir. So,
sure.
till the next time we meet, on behalf of RPG Life Sciences, take care, goodbye, and stay safe. Thank you.